Wake and wait, Kris Archie and Squessa Cotton de Gelmo from Seskin. Hi everyone, that's me saying hello in my language. My name is Kris Archie. I'm really excited to be here today. My mother's community is called Seskin. We call it Broken Rock. The federal government calls it Canem Lake Indian Reserve Number 5, but they don't know a thing about making good names. Yeah. My dad is a fourth generation settler Canadian. My great uncle still has the original, 160-acre plot in the prairies, which is a piece of land that I've never been to, but I'm really interested in putting my feet in that soil because I'm very connected to the soil where my ancestors come from on my mother's side. So that's a little bit about me. Just to tell you a little bit about the panel format, we're going to have each of our lovely panelists is going to do a 10-minute presentation. And from there, it's just going to be a casual conversation with an opportunity for some Q&A at the end. We really want to make sure that folks have kind of all the time to ask questions and be curious and do all of the things. Come on in, take a seat. We're just beginning. And so that's where we're at. Aaron, the lovely young fellow who just sang, has not made it up here yet, so I'll ask him to introduce himself when he arrives. One of the things that's really important to me always is for me to express myself and talk about who I am in my own language when given the opportunity, and so that's actually the decision kind of made by the panelists as well, was to do their own introduction, so I'll invite you to do that. And so an introduction of yourself, just like kind of who you are, and also a question that I'm throwing in is, can you also tell us the name of one of your favorite learners or one of your favorite educators?
Gwe Medawalain, Nin Deluisit Lisa Lenny Borden, Nin Deleawin Migamagi, Wildasi Ek Iskuk. So I am not greeting you in my own language. I'm greeting you in Aaron's language, who's not here. And I do that because I honor the Mi'kmaq people who have taught me so much over my entire life, basically. So I am from... look, and he just missed me speaking Mi'kmaq. I may do it again. You never know. So I'm from St. Francis Xavier University in Anakanish, Nova Scotia, but I began my teaching career in 1995 in Wagalma First Nation. So I was there when Aaron talked about Mi'kmaq Ginamatnawe. I was a teacher in the system as Mi'kmaq Ginamatnawe came to be. And so I've spent a lot of time learning from elders within the Mi'kmaq community about how to teach math in ways that connect to the ways of knowing that are inherent in the community. And so that's what I want to share with you today. My own heritage is quite complex. My ancestors have been in this country for a very, 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 very long time. My grandmothers are Acadian. I trace my ancestry back to Port Royal and to Grand Chief Member 2. He's my 11th great-grandfather, but I do not consider myself to be Mi'kmaq or Métis. I am a settler. I grew up white, with all the privileges and benefits of being a poor white kid, but a white kid. It's an honor for me. I'm probably one of the few Acadian people who, when they found Henry Member 2 in their tree, actually knew who he was beforehand. On my grandfather's side, I'm of Irish descent. I grew up in St. John, New Brunswick, and I don't have time to go into lots of detail, but I was surrounded by Indigenous knowledge. One of my favorite places in the world is the Kennebecasis River, where my grandparents in the 1940s built a summer camp. And I say that's kind of like where I go to get in the river once a year, and that's kind of like my healing for me. But I didn't know until I was about 40 years old that Kennebecasis was a Mi'kmaq word. That means Little Long Bay. So I grew up surrounded by Indigenous knowledge, but didn't have a lot of opportunities to learn about it until I became a student at St. Evex and began working in Mi'kmaq communities with an organization called X Project, and then eventually went on to become a teacher in Wagalma First Nation, and I now am a teacher educator at St. Evex. So.
Thank you. And so, Aaron, we're just doing an introduction. Introduce yourself how you would like. I'll save you for last. And... and then we'll go into the presentations after. Thank you.
Anin, Wawatasemanadukwe and Ishnakaz, Bachawama First Nation and Dunjaba, Mount Albert Nima, Anishinaabe Kwe and Dao, Hmong and Dotem. So when we introduce ourselves, we make sure that it is well known, like where we're from, where our ancestral roots are. And so what I've told you in my introduction is my name gifted to me by my two aunties. Get a little emotional about it because I know a lot of our kids don't have that connection to culture, and I know that I'm so lucky to have that in our family. My auntie Miriam is a fluent speaker. Both are just amazing women, strong women. I've also told you my clan, which is Loon. And so the Loon is the internal chief, the one who heals relationships and the ones who leads in a quiet, gentle way. And I've also told you where I'm from. So my mother is actually a first-generation immigrant from Italy, so speak a little bit of Italian. I actually understand a lot, which is fun in conversations when people don't expect it.
I do the same thing with Mi'kmaq.
Yes, it's so fun. And then my father is part of an ancestral line that can be traced back, way back, along the Agua shores. And so when we think about Lake Superior and Agua Canyon and Agua pictographs and the river, that is my ancestral roots. So there's a strong connection with family there. Agua is actually not our original last name. Oguayo is. And my grandfather's roots, that was on his marriage certificate to my grandmother. I'm very proud of who I am. I always, hope to be leading in a good way, and signs and things happen on a daily basis that remind me that I'm on a good path. And just even last week, a friend who has the gift of seeing had told me that my great-grandmother was standing beside me and she could see her. So I want to honor Eunice today, because I think that's pretty cool when people have gifts that they can share like that with you, and you know you're on a good path. I think the question you asked was, our learner.
Favorite learner or your favorite educator?
That is probably the hardest question to answer right now. I have a huge group of people I deeply respect. Lisa's one of them. I'm so excited to share space with Lisa. Bev's here too. And I think of Dr. Ruth Beatty and Danielle Blair and just these amazing women who are showing our non-Indigenous population how to do things in a good way and how to honor community voice. And I think that, those are things that we need to learn from. But my favorite learners right now are my kids. Mm-hmm. My kids are so smart. And I'm not just saying them because they're mine. But they teach me something every day about strength and strength of voice. And, my oldest, we were driving and two deer crossed the road. And long story short, she was like, I feel like that's my Papa Pete's mom and her friend who had passed away in the same day on two very different circumstances. And she said, we have to stop and lay our sema. And when we stopped, she said, Mom, look at how gross this is. People are not respecting our environment. We need to do something about it. And now she's trying to start an eco group at her school. And I love that when we empower our kids, they're creating change. They know how to create change. Mm-hmm. And so we need to honor that voice. And so, I'm a big fan of my kids who teach me a lot every day.
Thank you. Would you mind just leaving that door open for us? Or maybe a back door? Can you see if it has a way to stay open? There's no one kind of wandering these halls. I think given it's a weekend, it's probably safe to just try and keep it open. Folks get really nervous and shy, right, when they're like, is it a push or a pull door? Great. Okay, so over to Aaron. So introduction, and then the question was just name a favorite learner or an educator in your life.
My name's Aaron Prosper. I'm from Waywistonic, or Eskazon. It's a land of the fir trees, or where the fir trees are plentiful. My parents' names are Floyd and Donna Prosper. They're also from Eskazon. My grandparents' names are Wilfred and Bessie Prosper. They were from the Chapel Island First Nation, or what we call 1943, they were centralized to my current community under the Indian Act centralization policy, which started in the 40s. And then from there, that's where we've lived ever since, in Escazone. And then I said, thank you for being here, thank you for listening, thank you for gathering. It's like, thank you for gathering. So that's me in a nutshell, in the traditional way we introduce ourselves. In terms of what I do, so as you probably heard in the panel, I'm a student researcher, so I research under Dr. Amy Bombay of Dalhousie University. Dr. Bombay has done a lot of work in intergenerational trauma in residential schools. And so my work with her is we are moving beyond kind of the social aspects of intergenerational trauma and getting into behavioral sciences, epigenetics, microbiota research, many, many things. And so my work is not in a lab pipetting stuff, but more or less on the social applications of basic sciences. And the ethics of how we study science in the community and the impacts it has in the community and how that can be applied in a broader sense. And so I have a big belief that, you know, basic science is very, you know, in public or mainstream society is very narrowed down and can only be applied one way. And so I'm looking at how can we expand that? How can we go from test tube to, you know, our social interactions? And everything in between. And so that's what I do at Dal, for the most part. And other than that, my favorite teacher or learners, I don't have children, so 21.
I was dreaming of parents.
My grandmother was 18, I think. Yeah. I got married first. My favorite learners, my elders, my communities. I've been very fortunate to work with many elders from many different communities. The one in particular, Albert Marshall, has been instrumental in my learning. Albert Marshall has really spearheaded the concept of two-eyed seeing. And so if any of you have heard of that, that was pushed by Albert Marshall. That was brought to the mainstream, and now it's CIHR funding, grants. If it has anything to do with Indigenous people, you need some component of two-eyed seeing. And so I can go on later if what that is, but I can name so many. Janet Armstrong, Mandalay and Dion Stout, Willie Ermine, Peter O'Cheese, so many people I've learned from.
Thank you. Thank you so much to all three of you. I'm really looking forward to the panel. I know folks are really also excited to hear from each of you. So I'm going to just go and take a front row seat over here. You're welcome to stay sitting there, but if you'd like to see the panel.
I think we need to click, so.
Yeah, so what I'm going to do is have Lisa, she'll begin.
Stand.
Then we'll do Pamela and Aaron for 10 minutes.